Hi, my name is Dr. Jessica Barton. I am presenting some information today on hernias, what they are, how we fix them, and what you can expect if you're having surgery for your hernia. A hernia is a bulge due to fat or bowel that protrudes through a hole in our abdominal wall or groin through muscle or connective tissue. There are various causes of hernias. The main causes are congenital, which are hernias that are present at birth, acquired hernias, which are hernias that develop over time from muscle weakness or injury from excessive straining, and incisional hernias, which develop at prior incision sites. It also should be noted that hernias can form or become more noticeable before, during, or after pregnancy due to increase in abdominal size and pressure at that time. There are some general symptoms of hernias that we often hear in the office. These would be things such as a visible bulge in the area of the hernia on the abdomen or in the groin, especially noted by patients when they're straining, coughing, or lifting. They may have pain at the site of the hernia, or you may notice just a pressure or a dull ache, or sometimes even a burning sensation. There are a few different types of hernias. You can see in the picture here, it shows the main types that we're going to talk about today, which are inguinal hernias, femoral hernias, umbilical hernias, and ventral hernias. There are various types of ventral hernias. They include spaghellian hernias, umbilical hernias, epigastric hernias, which you can see on the photo. Inguinal hernias of note are the most common type. These are present in about 1 in 4 men and 1 in 25 women. Femoral hernias, however, are more common in women, though inguinal hernias are still the most common hernia overall. Umbilical hernias are more common in women, about 3 times more so than men. And ventral hernias, because there are multiple different types of hernias that fall under this category, don't really have a predisposition by gender. Some of my patients ask me if there are certain hernias based on their size or complexity that could be more difficult or challenging to fix. The short answer to that is yes. Patients who have larger hernias, hernias that are at prior incision sites, such as incisional hernias, hernias that were previously repaired, called recurrent hernias, these can all be more challenging to fix. These hernias are best repaired by those of us that are at higher volume centers, where we can actually provide a multidisciplinary team approach to make sure that you're having the best outcome if you have one of these more complex hernias. The way that we'll diagnose your hernia if you come to visit in the office will be with a physical exam to start and possibly with imaging studies that we'd order after your visit. The imaging studies may be an ultrasound or a CAT scan. There are various ways that we can treat hernias. The big question for patients when they visit in the office is usually if they have a hernia, does it need to be fixed? The only way that we know we can fix a hernia is with surgery to repair the hole in the muscle or connective tissue. However, there are sometimes hernias that are completely asymptomatic that we sometimes just have patients undergo surveillance for. If patients have more urgent or emergent issues, which you can see in the photos here, where sometimes bowel can get stuck in the hole or it can cause the blood supply to be lost to the bowel when it's strangulated, those situations are more emergent and these patients often present through an emergency room rather than through the office. Both patients who have pain from their hernias or these emergency situations, the only definitive way to treat that is with surgery. When patients are planning for an elective hernia repair that we schedule, there are ways that we can help them to treat their symptoms while they're awaiting their surgery. There are some things that we need to do to optimize you as a patient to make sure you have the best outcome. And in order to treat the symptoms, some of the things we recommend is having more rest rather than strenuous activities, avoiding heavy lifting. Typically, we like you to limit to about 30 pounds if you're really having symptoms with lifting and a hernia. Avoiding constipation by using things like stool softeners and fiber supplements so that you can more easily have a bowel movement, and engaging in things like physical therapy programs, which can really help with your strength and overall movement, even small things like going from sitting to standing or rolling over in bed, that the physical therapist can really work with you on to make sure that you have your symptoms controlled until you can actually get the surgery to fix your hernia. And then finally, there are some types of support belts or tight-fitting shorts or undergarments. These can sometimes just help to provide some extra support over the area of your hernia, but it's important to discuss this with us, what exactly you'll be using, so that we can make sure it's being used properly. Now we're going to talk about the different ways we can repair a hernia with surgery. There are 3 main methods for repairing hernias. There's open surgery, there's laparoscopic surgery, and robotic-assisted surgery. Open surgery is the longest historical way that we've repaired hernias. That's a procedure that is quite effective. But as we've transitioned from open surgery to more minimally invasive approaches with laparoscopic and robotic, we're seeing differences in things that we can do within the operating room and also in terms of your recovery. The way that we decide to fix your hernia is on a case-by-case basis. This will be tailored to each patient based on the type of hernia they have, different risk factors that they have, and your anatomy. The surgeon will decide whether an approach with a minimally invasive or an open technique is the best for you and to have the best outcome. When we talk about minimally invasive surgery, in particular robotic surgery, which has become much more popular over the last several years, especially in hernia repair, there are a few reasons why there are some benefits with this as opposed to laparoscopic or open surgery. Some of those are listed here. This is the latest technology in minimally invasive surgery. And what I mean by that is that we have better cameras with more optimal 3D viewing capabilities, more crystal clear view of your anatomy when we're operating, and we have a finer control of the instruments that we can actually move inside your body through ports that we place in the abdominal wall. This allows for the surgeon that's doing your operation with a robotic technique to be able to have great precision that's controlled by them while they're sitting on a console next to the operating room table in the room. This type of technique has been shown to lead to faster return to work due to a faster recovery and less pain that requires less narcotic pain medication. With any surgery that I offer to a patient, we always discuss that there's possibility of infection at incision sites, infection within the belly. There can be bleeding complications, there can be chronic pain issues, or injury to things that are nearby. The risks of these things are usually minimal, but when these occur, we need to know as surgeons how we can handle these best and make sure that you're aware of those risks so that we can plan in case any of those things occur. When we talk about hernia surgery in particular, some of the things that we focus on as surgeons to try to minimize the complications are ways that the patients and ourselves can work together to reduce the chance of a hernia recurring, reduce the chance of any chronic pain or swelling at the site of their hernia repair, and reduce the chance of any mesh-related issues such as infection or migration of the mesh. When we talk about the chances of a hernia recurring or coming back again, those recurrence rates vary quite a bit. The range is quite wide, from about 0.5 to 20%. And the reason that that is such a wide range is because it depends on multiple factors. This includes things such as the site of the hernia, the type of repair that you have, the clinical circumstance, such as is this an emergency case or an elective planned case, and some patient factors that we try to help address before surgery to reduce the recurrence rates, such as obesity or smoking, poorly controlled diabetes, or if you've had a prior hernia repair. What can we do in order to help you succeed at having the best outcome with your hernia repair? We've talked about some of the ways that we as surgeons try to make sure that we're providing the best technique and the best tools in order to do your surgery. The other thing that we can do is support you during your course of treatment with our multidisciplinary team approach. This includes what you see listed here on the bottom, things like weight optimization, where we can work in coordination with our nutrition department, our bariatrics teams, and our endocrinologists in order to support you with change in nutrition or medications or even surgical options if you need assistance with a weight optimization before hernia repair. We also try to assist with smoking cessation. We often coordinate this with your primary care physician. Along with the weight optimization and the endocrinology involvement, we try to work with your family physician and or your endocrinologist to make sure that if you're a diabetic, that you have adequate glucose control before we proceed with your surgery to reduce complications such as infection. And finally, we work with our physical therapy department so that they can help optimize your ability to move before and after the time of your surgery without pain or discomfort so that you can get back to doing all of the things you love to do in your everyday life. So what can you expect before surgery? First, you'll have a visit in the office, and this is when we'll discuss this multidisciplinary team approach based on your needs. If your physical exam warrants additional workup with imaging, this will be ordered at the time of your initial visit with the surgeon. The office will then arrange a time to schedule your surgery based on your specific needs using our surgical coordinator. And then our pre-admission testing department and your other physicians will help to make sure that you're safe to undergo your operation by ordering any blood work that you need and providing any clearances that you need to undergo anesthesia for your procedure. Once your surgery has been scheduled and you've finished your pre-admission testing and clearances, you would present to the hospital and arrive to the main lobby. You'll be taken to the preoperative area where you'll be checked in, and the nurses in the preoperative area will get you ready for your surgery that day. For the operation, you'll be moved to an operating room for your surgery, and the anesthesia team and the nursing staff in the operating room will help to put you under anesthesia so that you'll be fully asleep and comfortable for the procedure. Once the procedure is finished, the anesthesia team and the nursing staff will help you to recover from your surgery by moving you from the operating room to a recovery room where you'll be closely monitored until you're ready to go home. There are a few topics that I like to go over with patients in terms of their recovery. Pain management plans will be discussed with each patient based on their needs during their initial office visit and on the day of surgery to ensure that there's a good plan for them to be discharged from the hospital after their surgery. Most patients who undergo hernia surgery will be ready to go home the same day as their surgery. In terms of diet and activity, most patients can return to their regular diet immediately. Typically, the first few days, we recommend a more bland diet just to ensure you don't have any nausea or vomiting complications from anesthesia effects, and then just slowly advancing to normal as you feel fit. In terms of activity, most patients can go home, do their normal activities within their house, walking around the house, using the stairs, making food for themselves, bathing, showering, within the first few days. If you take it easy the first week, you tend to have less swelling, which leads to less pain and a quicker recovery. The main limitation is going to be to avoid any strenuous activity, particularly any heavy lifting more than 30 pounds, for about 6 to 8 weeks after surgery. How long and how much activity needs to be avoided is based on your type of hernia and repair. This will be discussed in detail based on your case by your surgeon. And then finally, for ongoing recovery and return to work and school, most patients will find that they can return to school or work duties within 3 to 7 days. And for ongoing recovery, for things that you're trying to get back to or maybe couldn't do before, now that your hernia is fixed and you'd like to get back to it, the physical therapy department will work with you at about 12 weeks after your hernia repair to help you to strengthen your abdominal muscles so that you can get back to all of the things that you love to do. So if you have any concerns about your hernia and you'd like to have an evaluation, please give us a call and we're happy to see you and talk to you about all of this in more detail.